a draft transport strategy now that it's been confirmed. And it's built on three pillars, which is healthy streets for healthy people, which is, in effect, ensuring that all streets around London are places where people can spend money, spend time and spend money as well, and feel safe and feel comfortable, and can walk, cycle, and aren't as motor dominated as some of the streets in London are. The second pillar is a good public transport experience, which is making sure that services are affordable, are comfortable, that there is sufficient capacity and are accessible. And the third pillar is new homes and jobs, which is making sure that transport policy, transport planning dovetails with spatial planning and with the transport we provide and the new services that we provide enable the growth in homes that London needs. So that's just a little bit of context for anyone who hasn't seen that before. Everything that we do should feed into one or more of those policy areas. So I'm going to very, very briefly talk about the Elizabeth Line, because it's not actually possible to talk about our business plan without talking about the Elizabeth Line. As anyone who has been paying attention to the news of the last few months will know, back in August, Crossrail Limited informed the mayor, informed us, informed the Stock Exchange and the DfT that they would not be meeting the December 2018 deadline for opening the central section of the route between Abbey Wood and Paddington. Subsequent to that, there were further announcements and further delays. The position that we're in now, and I just wanted to kind of outline this, there is now a new senior team in place at Crossrail Limited. So Mark Wild, who was formerly the managing director of London Underground and has a background in civil engineering, is now in place, and his main job there is to get the project back on track, to review what's gone wrong, and to put in place a realistic schedule for when we can get the central section up and running as quickly as possible. Alongside that, the Mayor has reached an agreement with a funding group with government to pick up any shortfall. Obviously, delays cost money in major infrastructure projects. So there is now an agreement that the government will loan the money, which will be paid back through the mayoral community infrastructure levy over a period of time. So that we're now confident that we're not going to run out of money on delivering the project. The next piece of work that is now going to take place, and it's happening right now, is a full review of all the Crossrails. Obviously, whilst all the work is still ongoing, and there are trains running, tons of dynamic testing has begun, so there is still good stuff happening. But the next thing that we're expecting to happen, following the full review by the new leadership team at Crossrail Limited, is to be presented with a revised schedule of when we can expect the central section to open. And I think we've been told that to expect that new schedule in spring, so we're hoping to get that fairly imminently. It was important to get that out of the way. It's obviously massively disappointing. I know the boroughs, the people in Greenwich will be very disappointed, the TfL very disappointed. It was important to kind of you put that into context, because when we're talking about TfL's finances, a lot of what we had previously been forecasting, some of that had been predicated on some of the revenue we would be getting from the Elizabeth Line when it was up and running. So we published that new business plan, and there are some considerable financial challenges in there. Crossrail being a fairly major one. As we mentioned before, we used to get an operating grant from the government, circa about £700 million a year. That's now gone. Although we have been preparing for that, when lined up next to the challenges that we've had with delays to Elizabeth Line, and also a drop in ridership, which we think is an economic issue. I think sometimes when you see a drop in ridership, just in buses, you can attribute it to maybe roadworks or bus becoming less attractive, dropping speeds and stuff. When you see it across the board, across a range of different modes, including the tube, it does point to a wider economic picture. Ridership has been dropping for certainly over the last year, 18 months. So recently on the tube, we've started to see increase again, which is promising, but far too early to draw any trends out there. So what we have is a picture where We've got significant financial pressures on revenue, and we've had to have a really strong think about what we can be delivered and what can't. But to put that into context, though, we are still delivering a lot in this business plan. There's a record £2.8 billion being invested in the healthy streets agenda that I mentioned before, so that's airports, safer junctions, cycling infrastructure, making the roads more pedestrian friendly. We're also continuing to grow the network, so we're continuing to investigate a number of major projects and progress a number of major projects, such as Bakerloo Line extension, such as potential public transport extensions to the Abingdon Thamesmead area. We're continuing with the Northern Line extension, and a few other things I'll come on to in a moment, which are specific to the borough. We have in other areas had to make some compromises. So, for example, some of the major upgrades to the tube network that we're planning that ran at a significant cost. Some of those, although we're still planning them, we now can't say for certain when they'll exactly when we'll be progressing those projects. So, raise the central line is a good example. Raise the Camden Town tube station is another one. I think the other thing, just in the context of our financial picture, is that our current deal with government for funding runs up to 2021. If you're going to plan a multi-billion pound transport investment to make as complex as the tube, we need longer term certainties, not about going back and asking them to necessarily reinstate the grant, but just to be able to plan longer than 3 years in the future about what our financial picture is going to look like. That's something that we are going to be asking government for in the next comprehensive spending review. So what does that specifically mean for Greenwich? Well, there's quite a lot of good news here. And I'll come on to some of these bits specifically. We're getting a brand new fleet of DLR trains, and that's been trailed before, but it's still in there, which is good news. And actually, it's a little bit better news than we previously advertised, which again I'll come to in a bit more detail. We're continuing to build a new cycle lanes. So the tunnel's still going ahead. We're still continuing to work with the GLA and the borough on how we can improve the public transport. The Liverpool Neighbourhood Fund, which is funding the improvements to Greenwich Centre, that has been protected in this plan. We are continuing to clean and modernise the bus fleet. And of course, as you'll know, we have recently upgraded and in the process of bringing back into service a higher capacity, more environmentally friendly, hopefully more reliable when we get all the needles worked out, Woolwich Ferry. So, as I mentioned before, new fleet of DLR trains. This is something that we had talked about before, and we've gone out to tender on this. But just in the context of the financial challenges, I don't think it's understating it to say that it is good news that we are still planning on replacing the full fleet of 43 DLR trains with new, high-capacity, walk-through, air-conditioned trains, which will have real-time information, will have charging points. In addition to that, which again is something that we had trailed before, we had a successful housing infrastructure bid from government, which has, amongst other things, such as improvements to some stations, will allow us to buy an estimated 14 extra trains. Say estimated because we haven't got the tenders back yet, but broadly we think that will allow us 14 extra units. The housing infrastructure fund bid is ostensibly to help us deliver more houses in the rural docks, but will of course, in terms of buying new trains, benefit the entire route. One of the key things about the DLR, and anyone who's heard me talk about the DLR before will hear me say this a lot, it is the highest performing railway in the country by quite a stretch, regularly around the 98-99% reliability mark, which means it's very, very difficult to get any more out of the existing fleet than what we have. The only real way we can start to improve capacity and improve performance is to buy new trains, and that's what we're doing. Both new trains are expected to come in 2023-24. Obviously, we'll update you if we go through that procurement process. New cycle routes. As you may have seen again, we have confirmed the cycle single highway 4 from Greenwich to Southwark, to Tower Bridge specifically, and work is expected to begin this summer. There are some sections of that route, particularly around Lower Road in Southwark, where there's still areas we need to consult on. But effectively, the Greenwich to Lewisham stretch, we've got bottomed out now, we know what we're doing, and work Greenwich now centre to watch. I know this is something that's been highly anticipated because as part of that work we'll be looking at having a scheme round about Woolwich Road Junction. I know it goes by a few different names, where a cyclist was sadly killed last year. So that is something, a piece of work we're doing now, working with the borough, and we're expecting a consultation by the end of the year on what that's going to look like. And thankfully, for anyone who gets it with slightly clunky cycle names, we're also in the process of renaming what we call our cycle routes. And so we have about five different names depending on what the cycle route looks like. So hopefully that will get a bit less confusing for people who are interested in these things as well. So the town tunnel, since we last spoke a year ago, we have consent from government. A contract, we're appointing a contractor that is expected to be confirmed by this summer, with work to begin by the end of the year. Completion, it says there, not before the end of 2024, which I would read as end of 2024, if we're looking, probably 2025. Again, there's, you know, I think one of the things that sometimes gets missed on this is that this is actually a fantastic news story for public transport. At this point in time, there's only one bus east of Tower Bridge that crosses the river, and that's the one way. Single decker buses, you can't get anything bigger than a Royal High Tunnel or Blackwell Tunnel. It's not particularly reliable, it's not particularly popular because of the problems at the Blackwell Tunnel. By building a larger port tunnel and by freeing up some of the traffic in that location, we think we can get up to 36 buses per hour through the tunnel, which will revolutionise cross river bus transport in East London. And in fact, it would say up to 36 buses per hour. In the development consent order, in the permission that the DfT gave us, it specifies that there should be no fewer than 20 buses per hour. So there is a. That's a good question. You know, I think, I think 20 buses now is each one of us, well, in total. But yeah, so there is a hard minimum on that that's been set by the government. And we've also made a number of other commitments to the host boroughs for Greenwich and New and Southampton. So, as you may know, there'll be a user charge on this end of Blackwell Tunnel, which is aimed at suppressing demand to make sure that the phenomenon, which is, and you'll know, is induced traffic, where sort of if you build it, they will come phenomenon, doesn't take hold. But for residents in the borough, we will be waiving, there's a registration card, we'll be waiving that in the first year. We're going to be giving a discount to people in lower income homes that will work quite similar to a scheme we already have on buses and trams, which is a 50% discount for people on certain types of benefits. There will be a £1 million fund for local businesses. There will also be increased cycle infrastructure, including free cycle bus that will be running through the tunnel as well. There are a number of other conditions, but a key one, I think, for the borough, for the residents of the borough, is that we're committed to, and we will be very soon engaging the residents on noise barriers for residents to see the boat. And we're also consulting to the local school because we know that there are concerns about pollution from the A102. So, you know, the barriers will also assist with that, and that's something that we're talking to the school as well about how we can implement that, what it looks like, what the actual physical nature of those barriers are. Public transport intensity, sometimes called DLR intensity, sometimes, but we don't really want to preempt it. Because fundamentally, when the mayor kind of reviewed river crossings, one of the things that he looked at was how can you best enable growth in housing in Hollywood and Thamesmead, which is an opportunity area. And also because if you're wanting to get very large, very complicated consent for something like a rail extension, you need to show that you've considered a range of options when you go to that transport works and call it here. So currently, we're working with the GLA on the area planning framework for Thamesmead and Hollywood. As part of that, we will be setting out, depending on the level of growth that can be expected in that area, what transport interventions are necessary and what are affordable. So as part of that study, we've kind of highlighted three options there. It's not an easy map to read at the distance, but a DLR extension from Gallings Reach is one of the options. Extending the London Overground ground from Barking Riverside. We're currently in the process of extending it from Barking to Barking Riverside at the moment. So you then bring that south across the river to Abbey Wood, connect it into the Elizabeth Line, and also it does transit. So if anyone's not familiar with that, that's an idea that's been kicked around for a while. It is a fully segregated bus route with limited stops, sort of rationalised. So you're fully segregating the traffic, it's quicker, it's a simplified route, and it's like a step change. I think sometimes it gets described as being more like a tram on the fires than a bus. So, you know, kind of like bus priority, but, you know, but much better, much more reliable. So they're the three options we're looking at. I believe the GLA are due to consult on this, and these options will be set at that consultation later this year. Don't have a specific date for that, so we will keep you up to date if we know more. So they are the sort of the key stories at the business plan for the borough. There are a few other priorities that we're working on as part of the mayor's transport strategy. As many of you will know, that air quality, reducing nitrogen dioxide, reducing particulate matter in the air is one of the mayor's one of the things that's closest to the mayor's heart. And there are a series of proposals and interventions that TfL have been working on since the mayor came into power. So the current situation is that we have the low emission zone for heavy vehicles, which is London wide, which is Euro 4 standard for most bus vehicles. And then we have the T charge right now, which the mayor introduced in 2017, which is the congestion charge zone, which again is Euro 4 standard for all other vehicles. If you don't meet those standards, then you have to pay a charge. As of this April, the T-charge will be replaced by the ultra-low emission zone, which is 24 hours a day. It is a £12.50 charge for most vehicles, I think something like a day for heavy vehicles. It sets a higher standard for diesel vehicles of Euro 6. That's quite a stretching target. I think some Euro 6 vehicles are only about 3 years old. And it's aimed at reducing the amount of pollutants from road traffic, which is about half of all pollutants in London come from road traffic, and a good chunk of those come from diesel vehicles. So that's this year, and we're currently preparing for that to go in a couple of months. But it doesn't stop there, so the low emission zone, which is currently Euro 4, as of next year, will be the same standard as the ultra low emission zone. Any bus, any lorry, any coach across the entirety of London from October next year will have to meet Euro 6 standard, including TfL buses. And that will have a major impact, particularly on some of those busier trunk roads, on some of those areas where there's a lot of traffic going through. And then, I think 1 year later, the ultra low emission zone expands from central London up to, but not including, the north and south circular roads. Which is the reason that area was chosen, because predominantly and overwhelmingly the air quality problem is focused in central and inner London. When you get into some parts of outer London, the problem tends to be more localised around some of the major roads than across the entire of London. So that with the same standards and the same charge as what's going to be this year. So for most vehicles, £12 a day, and for heavy vehicles, £100 a day. Anyone wasn't aware of that, we're currently working very closely with the Borough's Commons to try and get the message out, and hopefully you're seeing some of that message. We brought some leaflets along today. If anyone wants to share them with their constituents, we'd be more than happy to send on some more. As part of that, we are changing the bus fleet. As I mentioned before, every one of these new standards that we're bringing in, we're holding ourselves to. So every bus going into central London as of April will need to be Euro 6. And from October next year, every bus across the entire of London will need to be Euro 6. But that's just a bare minimum. We're already in the process of phasing out fully diesel vehicles, so every new double deck bus we buy is a hybrid bus. We are effectively, we're working towards the goal of all of our 9,000 buses being zero emission and tailpipe by 2037. That's a big ask, because some of those larger buses, the technology isn't quite there yet. However, we have a lot of buses through our contracts, and that allows us to innovate. So one of the things we're doing to reduce the cost of upgrading our fleet is actually retrofitting some of the double-deck buses rather than buying new Euro 6 buses. been possible because we have purchasing power, because we run a, you know, one of the largest bus fleets in Europe. And as a result of that, we're in the process of trialing new technology, wireless charging, so a bus doesn't necessarily have to be hooked up to a charging unit for 4 or 5 hours, biofuels, so, you know, we're trying a whole range of new things. The mayor's been working, talking with bus providers around the world about how we can meet these challenging targets. Another key priority for now, it's one that I don't think has had as much press coverage at the moment, but it's something we certainly want to get a message out about, is Vision Zero. So as part of the Healthy Streets programme, there are 10 indicators of healthy streets. So from, is there somewhere comfortable to sit down, is it too loud, what's the air quality like, a range of things, but one of the key, if not the key part, is how safe the streets in London are. So what Vision Zero is a target to have no deaths on the road, or people die or have life-changing injuries on the road by 2041. Which is an incredibly challenging target. However, it's really the only target you can set. There is no acceptable level of saying, well, it's okay, well, we'll set the target and 5 people can die this year. And in fact, what it is, what it's about is bringing the mindset from other walks of life where you have any kind of system, whether it's other parts of the transport network, whether it's about construction site work. In the workplace, no one would accept, there is no acceptable number of people to die in the workplace, and I think it's about taking that mindset and applying it to the roads. And part of that is, it's about creating, we've got, it says there that it's about, partly it's about what we're doing with the overall Healthy Streets agenda, which is about generally reducing car dominance and making streets places where you can walk and you can cycle and you can feel comfortable. But part of it is about creating safe systems. One of the things that we keep getting pushed back at is people will always do stupid things, so how can you reach that target? Well, people will always do stupid things, and people will always make mistakes as well. It's just, that is the way that humans are. So what you need to do is create safe systems that are forgiving of individual mistakes, which is safe speeds, reducing speeds on roads. We know increase the chance of someone surviving a collision. Safer streets, which with junctions and sort of just public spaces that are designed in a safer way. Safer vehicles, so as you may have seen, we are consulting on what is called the Direct Vision Standard. It's a standard for London, which for heavy vehicles coming to London, which will set the visibility from the cab that the driver, that lorry can have. Effectively, if you sit in some of the lorries that are driving around London, the person sat in the cab, they have very, very little visibility to outside of them. When you compare it to something like a bin one with big glass doors, and actually you've got fantastic visibility to outside. And there is a range, so we're developing a star system for rating the visibility available from vehicles, and we're setting standards of what is and isn't acceptable in the city. And also safer behaviour, so what can we do in training, what can we do with schools, how can we embed better behaviours in drivers and in all road users as well. So this is, like I say, one of the key policies of the name. It's an incredibly challenging target. Effectively, what this means is that any scheme that we put forward now, for any new scheme taking place on London roads, the first question will have to be, how does this make the road safe? And if a scheme, if we're pushing out a scheme that doesn't, then we need to think about it again. So they're the big sort of big picture strategic things. I'll just very quickly go on to talk about some of the services that we run in the borough, sort of Jubilee Line through North Greenwich. This is the graph of lost customer hours. Lost customer hours is a slightly arcane measure that I don't fully understand for judging the economic impact of delays on customers. So it takes into account how long, when you've got a train that's supposed to be every 3 or 4 minutes, how long should you wait, how long are you waiting for that train, and brings in a whole range of factors, sort of like where that's happening, what time of day it's happening, and effectively tries to monetize those delays to our customers. As you can see, the dotted red line there is what we should be achieving, and it's been not great over the last year. It's been patchy, it's gone up and down a bit. Broadly, we should be doing better, and there are a range of reasons why we're not. This is a partial from there. Signals, we only recently did the signalling on Jubilee Line, so that's suitably a small slice of the reasons as it should be. A fairly large chunk of it is down to fleet, trains breaking down, issues with doors, the usual kind of thing. Then a reasonable size chunk of that is staff, so that includes strikes, it also includes staff missing shifts and not being bailed on time. And then we've got 22%, which is down to our customers, which is interesting. Because that includes things like people getting stuck indoors and people getting ill on trains. Now, that sounds like slightly a callous thing to do to kind of equate that to delays, but what we find is that, and we've been doing a lot of work with London ambulances, what we find has been happening quite a lot is if someone gets ill on one of our trains, people will rush around and go, don't move them, don't move them. We need to get doctors and then the train sits there for however long it takes, and the person is there in a very cramped, very hot, very stuffy, environment, possibly not in the most comfortable position. We've done a lot of work with London Ambulance Service over the last year. We ran a campaign, which we trialled on the Jubilee Line. Basically, the advice from London Ambulance Service is that if someone gets ill on a train, you should get them off the train where they can be dealt with quickly by the ambulance service quickly. So we've run a information campaign on that. We're assessing how it's gone, and we're going to carry on trying to do work. We're also doing some work around some of these issues around platform edge doors and some of these. On the Jubilee Line, have you ever been on the train and it started and then it jumps? That's normally someone leaning against the door. And the reason that happens is because there are safety mechanisms in there. I think they're a little bit too sensitive on some of the tracks. So we're looking at things like software that is available that can just sort of a bit of time's marginal gains and start to get some of these causes of delays sorted out. The sort of DLRs I mentioned before is as usual up around 98-99%. We actually now set a target for number of train sets not up on time at 99%, which I think at the moment we're at 98.9, which is slightly disappointing. Excess waiting time is similar to lost customer hours, which is that it's how long you can expect to wait. If a train is only 10 minutes, you should expect to wait on average 5 minutes. That's how long people are waiting on top of that, on average. Lift availability has been very good. The one area where we're not hitting that target is the number of 20-minute delays, which speaks to the fact that when things are going wrong, they're going very wrong. Some of that's down to the age of the trains, like I said. Some of our trains are reaching the end of their natural life, which is another reason why we're buying new ones. Buses, something we were aware of, we recently completed a consultation on bus provision in central London. Effectively trying to rationalise it, there are lots of corridors, lots of roads in central London where the amount of capacity was far outstripping demand. We think that the fare which allows for the switch between buses without paying an additional fare has allowed us to rationalise that. We know that this has been quite an emotive subject. We've had a lot of responses and we're currently reviewing those now. And I would expect you to hear what the results of that are in the coming months. I think, yes, it's currently going all over City Hall for them to take a look at what the results were, what we should do next. There was only one bus in the review that actually goes to Greenwich, and that was the 53. And the change we proposed was cutting it back from Whitehall to Waterloo at the central London end, and a small reduction in frequency. We know that there have been a lot of comments about that, and again, they are being. I don't have the answer about what we're doing with it, they're being reviewed at the moment. And because we consulted on such a large number of routes together, everything we consult on, if any change we make to that might not affect something else. So as soon as we know, we'll come back to you with what the results are of that. The flip side of reducing the number of bus kilometres in central London is that we're now reviewing what's happening in outer London. With a view to actually increase the number of bus kilometres in outer London. It won't be a kilometre for kilometre, as in for everyone that we've reduced in central London, we will increase in outer London because we do still need to save a little bit of money, harking back to the business plan slides earlier on. But we are looking at increasing the number of buses available in central London, and certainly Blackpool will be included in that. And once we've got the central London conversations. That announcement came out before the announcement that the plan will be delayed, so those changes are still planned, but will be implemented closer to the time of the plan coming into service. Broadly, bus performance across the... It's very difficult because there are so many routes to kind of encapsulate it, and I'm more than happy to send you the full list, but it would be foolhardy to try and go through them all here without boring everyone to tears. Broadly, excess waiting time is around a minute. If you're waiting for a bus, that's again how long over what is time zone you expect to wait. The low frequency routes, 85% arriving on time. Finally, Woolwich Ferry. As you may know, we have introduced two new ferries. They're high capacity, they are more accessible, they are more environmentally friendly, and we have now begun running limited service. We've run some technical